around Dodge City and in the territory on West, there's just one way to handle the killers and the spoilers, and that's with a U.S. Marshal and the smell of gun smoke. William Conrad, the story of the violence that moved west with young America, and the story of a man who moved with it.
I'm that man, Matt Dillon, United States Marshal. The first man they look for and the last they want to meet. It's a chancy job, and it makes a man watchful and a little lonely.
I don't know what's got in him, Mr. Dillon.
Who, Chester?
Well, the president. President Grant.
Oh, what's he done now?
Well, letting them fellas take out a patent on that there barbed wire, that stuff's going to be the ruination of this country.
What's the president got to do with it? He can't stop it.
He can't? Well, then what's the good of him being president?
Just read your paper, Chester.
Barbed wire. Well, them British foreigners is fighting again. The Russos is what they're... Now what? Somebody started a ruckus there. Down there in the Long Branch.
Yeah,
Dillon.
Come on, Chester.
Matt, wait, Andrew. Stop him.
All right, Chester. All right, come on, hold him.
Get him,
hold
it. Me, Marshal, get him off.
Take hold of the other one, Chester, will you?
All right, now, Ambrose. Get up from there.
All right, son. Come on, get on your feet.
All right.
Come on.
All right, you don't have to break my arm.
Now, what's this all about, Ambrose? I thought you and Cully were friends.
I did too, Marshal, but not no more.
Well, what started it?
I was only joking, but Cully can't even take a joke.
Hey, well, next time I won't use my fists, Ambrose. If I come wearing a gun, you wait.
Not in Dodge, you won't. The next time I catch you two fighting, either one of you, I'll show you the inside of the jail. You want to shake hands?
What for? I had a belly full of his crazy temper. I'm good and through.
Well, what about that, Cully?
Well, what about it, Marshal?
Come on over to the bar, Matt. I'll buy you a drink for keeping my place from being smashed.
Okay, kitty, that sounds like fair payment.
You too, Chester.
Oh, thank you, Miss Kitty.
I don't know what got into that Cully tape lately. He was always polite as could be when he used to come into town with his mother.
His mother's dead 3-4 years now.
Mm-hmm. Look, now he's at the bar ordering a drink.
I think maybe I'll have a talk with him, Kitty. Maybe I can find out what's wrong.
Yeah, sure, Matt.
There you are, Sam. I'll pay for his drink.
Well, what's that for?
Well, for almost breaking your arm, you said. Go on, drink it.
Sure. Thanks.
You know, when a man's old enough to drink hard liquor, he's old enough to get in trouble, Cully. Now, what was it about?
Well, it's personal.
Sure, it always is, till it's a public fight. And it's my business.
Yeah, he said something about my old man. What about me?
Well, what?
He called us Squaw Men.
Squaw Men? Well, why?
Because it's true. It's the worst of it. About my old man, it's true anyways.
Oh, since when?
3 months. When he went to Texas for stock, he stopped at the agency in Darlington. Brought her back. An Arapaho woman. Now, that ain't right, Marshal. It just ain't right.
Now, wait a minute, Cully. A good many men have married Indian women, and sometimes they're real good marriages.
Good. Any man who marries one of them deserves to be called Squaw Man.
Look, Cully, your ma's been dead some years now. You're old enough to know how it is with a man.
Him mooning over her. Him old enough to be her father. She's more my age than his.
Well, that's not unusual with Indians. The women expect it.
Well, the worst is they ain't really married. Only Indian style. And for a good, God-fearing man, that ain't nothing at all.
Now, wait a minute, son. They are married. Maybe not legally, but if they both accept it...
And if they don't, what could she do about it?
Cully, I know your father. And Hardiman Tate isn't that kind of a man. Now, do you want me to talk to him?
No, I wouldn't do no good.
Well, he wouldn't send her back, no, but he might marry her legally.
You think that'd help? Thanks for the drink, Marshal.
You picked a nice day to ride this far. Getting on spring. Looks like good grass this year.
Yeah, we've had some rain.
Nice barn they got up there, ain't it?
Mm-hmm.
House ain't much so. Mr. Dillon, I disremember Ms. Tate. What was she like?
Now, Chester, she came from a long line of Puritan ministers, and she never let you forget it.
Yeah, my, sort of a deliverance for Mr. Tate then, wasn't it?
You might say so, yeah.
Seems like a mighty big jump, though, to a Arapaho squaw.
Yeah, it does, doesn't it?
Look, there's Cully out in front. And look at that. He's toting a gun, just like he said he would.
Uh-huh. Now, come on, we'll ride up anyway.
Well, Marshal.
Cully.
So you decided to come anyway.
Yeah, that's right. Father here?
Inside, with her. You go on and talk to him if you want. I got chores to do.
Well, Mr. Dillon, that boy ain't got a bit of toleration in him at all, has he?
But he's got a lot of his mother in him, though.
Well, Marshal and Chester, this is a surprise. How are you?
It's fine, Mr.
Good to see you, Hardy.
Come on in and sit. Now to see you, just fixing a meal, and I'll tell her to add a little to the pot.
No, thanks, Hardy. We can't stay. We just want to talk to you for a minute, that's all.
Has Cully got himself in trouble?
Oh, no. There's nothing like that.
And he's got so wild and unruly lately, I don't know what to expect. I can't figure what's eating on him.
Well, that's what I want to talk to you about, Hardy. I guess the boy's like his mother in some ways.
Oh, Cully's pious, that's sure, just like Abigail. Since she died, I don't go to church like I ought, I guess, and it makes the boy mad. Is that what you mean, Marshal?
I'm afraid it's more than that, Hardy. I think he's upset about your wife.
I know that, Marshal. But that's between us, the family. It ain't none of your business.
Well, I don't want to butt in. I didn't have that in mind. I just got a suggestion that might be of help to you, that's all.
What?
Bring her into town. Let the Reverend Tucker marry you.
We're already married.
In the Arapaho way, yeah?
Yes, in the Arapaho way.
Yeah, but Hardy, that's not legal, not for whites.
What's that got to do with it?
Look, Hardy, you bought her from her father. Now, that's against the law. You're living with her without benefit of marriage. That's against the law. Now, legally, I could and I should send her back to Darlington right now.
Oh, Marshal, you wouldn't.
Oh, now, please understand, Hardy. I'm trying to help you. The girl is willing. Marrying her will solve a lot of problems. Now, if she isn't, then I'm going to have to send her back anyway.
You can't send her back, Marshal.
Well, why not?
Come inside, both of you, please.
All right.
Now to see her.
Yes?
Come.
She's awful pretty, Mr. Dillon.
Yeah.
This is my wife, Nadasia. Little dear woman. This is Marshal Dillon, Chester Proudfoot.
How you do, ma'am?
Glad to know you, Miss Tate.
Yes. Glad.
She don't know much English, and I don't speak Arapaho very good, but we're both of us learning little by little.
You come eat?
Well, no thanks, Miss Tate. We got to get on back to Dodge.
I cook. Good.
Yes, ma'am, I bet you do.
Miss Tate, I'd like to ask you a question. Do you like it here? Do you want to stay here with him?
I like here. I stay. My husband.
All right, now to see you. You go back to the kitchen.
Your friends come more?
Well, sure. We'll be back.
You bet. Goodbye, Miss Tate.
Yes.
Yeah, you see what I mean?
Yeah.
She's everything a man could want.
You sound pretty happy, Artie.
I never knew the meaning of that word before. Oh, I don't mean no disrespect to Cully's mother, but...
Oh, no, I understand.
You won't send her back?
Look, Artie, it'd still be better if you came to town and let the Reverend marry you.
All right, Marshal. If you'll arrange it, we'll come in Saturday.
Well, good. Tell you what, we might even have a party after the wedding, huh?
By jing, that's a good idea.
By golly, she'd like that, I bet. Thank you, Marshal.
Sure. Goodbye, Hardy.
Goodbye.
We'll see you Saturday.
Goodbye.
Well, now, wasn't that a surprise? Pretty little thing like that, and him so happy and all. Why, it wasn't nothing like I'd thought to hear Cully talk, was it, Mr. Dillon?
No, it wasn't, Chester. You want to know something? That's kind of what bothers me.
You look like the cat that swallowed the canary.
Well, Doc, you ought to see. I've been over at the Long Branch, and Miss Kitty's got everything ready for the party. The preacher's wife even baked a cake.
There are more important elements, Chester.
Huh?
You can't have a wedding without a bride and groom, Chester.
Well, my gracious, no.
It's after 3:00 now. There's no sign of them yet.
My, you think there's something wrong, Mr. Dillon?
I don't know. Doc and I were just talking about it.
Marshal?
Oh, good. Come in, Reverend. Come in.
Thanks. Hello, Chester.
Doc.
How
do
you? How are you, sir? You haven't seen them?
No, I haven't.
Marshal, I'm getting worried. They wouldn't just not show up.
Well, they could have changed their minds.
About a wedding? I doubt it. I hope nothing's happened.
Well, if they were coming, they'd have been here by now. I think maybe Chester and I better ride out to the Tate place and see if there's anything wrong.
It's you, Marshal.
Who'd you think it was, Cully?
Well, he's all blood.
What's happened here? What's wrong? How'd you get those scratches on your face?
She done it. After I found them. She tried to kill me, Marshal.
What?
Just like she killed Pa.
When did this happen?
This morning. Just before they was to leave for town.
Well, why didn't you come and tell me about it?
Oh, I was scared, Marshal. She's out there somewhere and she wants to kill me. I was waiting for dark.
Where's your gun?
Well, she's got it. That's what she killed him with.
How'd she get it?
I must have stole it from my room, I guess. All I know, I heard the shot. I run out and she had the gun and I wrestled it away from her. That's when she scratched my face. And he was laying there, dead.
Where?
Out back, in the woodlot.
All right, let's go out there.
No! No, Marshal, I don't want to go out there again. I don't want to see him.
Hey, you better come anyway. Come on.
Yeah.
Look, there's a fire. My wife, Miss Tate. Now, what'd she want with a fire like that?
I don't know.
Mr. Dillon, looks like she's praying.
It's a death song, Chester. It's an Arapaho song of mourning.
Oh, but I don't see...
Up above, Chester, in the tree there.
Well, she's giving him a regular Indian burial.
Marshal!
You stay right with us, Cullen. There's the gun, Chester.
Yes, sir. I got it. Well, she don't even seem to notice us.
Miss Tate. Miss Tate.
Dead. Dead. My husband.
Mr. Dillon.
Look. Yeah, I see. You got something for a bandage, Chester?
What is it? What's the matter?
You got it easy!
Miss Tate. Miss Tate. Here, give me that knife. Give it to me. Chester?
Yes, sir. Here now, Miss Tate, you just say.
Dad. My husband.
Yes, ma'am.
Cully.
What?
I want to ask you about those scratches on your face, Cully. Weren't they made before and not after your father died?
What?
Now, when she scratched you, she was probably screaming, wasn't she?
No.
And your father heard, and he came running to find out what you were trying to do, and you shot him.
You're wrong.
All right, maybe it was self-defense. Maybe he would have killed you or hurt you bad, but you shot him first, didn't you?
No. No. A young girl like that with an old man. That ain't natural. She hated him.
No, she didn't hate him. She loved him. She could never have loved you.
That ain't true.
Yes, it is. Because an Arapaho woman doesn't mourn a husband she doesn't love. And if she didn't love him, she wouldn't have cut off two of her fingers. As soon as we get her bandaged up, we'll take you into Dodge.
Only meant to show him that she was no good. To show him how wrong it was. That's all I meant.
Do you believe that, Mr. Dillon?
No, Chester. But I think maybe he does.
Gunsmoke, produced and directed by Norman McDonald, stars William Conrad as Matt Dillon, U.S. Marshal. Featured in the cast were Parley Bear as Chester, Howard McNear as Doc, and Georgia Ellis as Kitty. George Walsh speaking. Join us again next week for another specially transcribed story on Gunsmoke. This is the United States Armed Forces Radio and Television Service.